the scooter here is what they said will match, actually march onto a car. So the needs of what the local systems will need and how that will happen is the game changer. And you know what you can get as power saving from a workload defined compute is not what you can get otherwise from a virtualized environment. Okay, because virtualized environment still runs on a compute which is 8-core, 10-core, 12-core or whatever it is, that kind of a module. And if you slice it thin, then you will not be able to run that many VMs, and if you slice it too big, then you cannot utilize it in full. So there is although you have power cycle controls, it's not that these two will meet end of day. And that's where you see a paradigm with the advent of all these mobile phones and ARM processors and Calcedas which are coming, you will see a trend which is made to define, a compute which is made for a specific type of workload, and you will start, this model will start emerging.
Yeah, isn't it going backwards? Well, we should have a compute which is specific to your workload. Cloud is supposed to take away all those requirements, and it's supposed to abstract away all that.
So a cloud never said that. Cloud's basic, that's why I put what is cloud's basic needs. And cloud doesn't say that what type of compute it's actually needing. And what it is doing is the industry is adopting to cloud and answering to cloud in different forms. And this is one of the forms which it is answering. The known form is virtualization, and there are trends which are happening, and these trends is what I wanted to introduce here. And I'm not trying to say which one is winning or not, because then suddenly I wear a HP hat, and I intentionally don't want to wear that hat out here. Okay. So a cloud never defines that it's virtual or physical. Cloud basically says I should be able to migrate, I should be able to do this, it should give me elasticity, I should be able to meter. That's the semantics. And the first slide which I put is primarily to say what's a cloud. Okay. And cloud says any form of compute can be cloud managed.
Say okay, you know, it could run on any hardware, x86 platform, we are all good, right? But it's up to the company, you know, how they want to position it, they want to go with NoSQL or SQL, so it's up to them how they want to, you know, have their cloud running, how they want to minimize their operational expenditure.
Sure, I agree there. So it doesn't say that this type of compute cannot come, okay? So you might see IBM's power someday coming into cloud, okay? I don't know when, but that's also a feasibility.
So just to add to your question, I work in Dell. So one of the problem which we were trying to address was that how can the cloud scheduler be intelligent to choose among the type of workload to be pushed to a type of particular type of compute node. So that's kind of a little futuristic, but certainly a lot of people, including us, are looking into that. That if I get 5 requests, and these requests are not all same, they are different. And there are different type of cloud compute nodes to be optimized for them. So can I have an intelligence built in that I can route it based on storage, based same with network, same with compute, and get the maximum output out of the cloud?
It's on top of that, not only compute, it's applicable for network also.
Yeah, so I agree. So I chose the topic as compute, and I kind of, if I touch networks and go on storage, I think I will not stick to my 15 minutes or 20 minutes. And I kind of stayed only with one topic and wanted to tease the brain of people out here, so that how do you want to look at, most of us look at virtualization, and there is a paradigm which is actually evolving, and how do you want to look at that paradigm. So this was a brain teaser and nothing else, and you know, I just wanted to play it that way, and that's all I wanted to do.
Basically, in the networking, maybe, you know, let me touch up something that I'm running into, and also, you know, it is part of Grizzly. So we introduced something called a service type, right? Mm-hmm. You define the service type what you want, and the driver will be chosen based on the service type the request is going to submit to the scheduler. So we are implementing that as part of Quantum, but, you know, it could be extendable to anything else.
So, you know, do you want it as part of flavors and service type as part of flavors? See, the only problem with the OpenStack is, when you put idea, you have 20 ways of putting idea, okay? And how do you say which one is right is a challenge. And that's where most of us struggle. And it's how to convince the community is one of the challenges. And
yes,
you will
exactly.
have to be pretty powerful inside the community to convince somebody or not get convinced. One of these two is true.
Yeah, actually, I was playing that role for some time, at least in the load balancer stuff. It's mediating, you know, the vendors, between the vendors and the community. And, you know, finally we agreed on the service type, at least in the quantum area. But, you know, it's almost like flavors. Yeah.
Yes. So any more questions?
He has been presented by Divyanshu, and he leads the OpenStack development and OpenStack initiative at Dell R&D. So I would like to welcome Divyanshu for taking up the next session. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everybody. You want to wait? Can you hear it? Want to take this one? Okay. So session just after lunch is not the most interesting session. I totally agree because I feel the same way. And a lot of things in lunch, so it was good overall. However, when I saw my slot and when I saw the slot, and initially when Atul contacted me to talk, I was planning to talk on quantum or something like that. But past 2-3 months or 5 months, I've been working OpenStack for kind of like 2 years now, when I jumped into that. And earlier when I used to visit two customers or talk to them, what actually is OpenStack used to be a very big question. They have not heard of it. They only heard of vCloud or Amazon or some competitive product. And we used to explain to them, this is what it is. But over a past of 5-6 months in my interaction, what I observed, people by and now know what OpenStack is. People by and now want to use OpenStack, because when we talk to our customers from Dell side, and we propose something on cloud computing, we hear, hey, are you guys doing OpenStack? So that's a good news. However, when we try to put a complete solution to them, to all the customers, we always struggle. Struggle in terms of that. Who will do this? Who will do load balancer? Who will do metering? Who will do billing? Where will I get the open hardware? Things like that. So that's the current state what we are seeing in India. I'm talking of some very big names. I can't put it in open, but like guys who are running close to $20-30 billion business, those sort of people, want to experiment with OpenStack because they understand the value of open source, but they don't know how to do that. So this presentation is kind of arranged around what are the customer problems which I saw here, and what these customer problems, do they like span to some opportunity, or to the very point, if they are not solved, can it be detrimental to OpenStack in terms of getting adopted by the business? And that will be the death knell which none of us want. It's good that we are strong on kind of technology. Best it came from NASA, it have all the 200 big names in the world you can think of. But end of the day, a Goldman Sachs or a Citibank or HDFC Bank has to consume it. Dell, IBM, HP, NetApp, awesome name. But we are, at the end of the day, a service provider to the OpenStack to a business. If they don't get the complete solution, chances are we are not going to take this story very far. So this presentation is all about that. It took me a lot of time to do that because that's not my core skill. I'm an engineering manager. I have done like 15 years of coding, mostly writing device driver for Linux. And however, I picked some business skill in the meantime and kind of read a lot of reports from KPMG to McKinsey to Pricewaterhouse and what actually these consultants, or big five as we call them, how they position cloud computing to the customer. Like if I go to some like big bazaar or a future group, chances are they will go to this big five and ask them to do an audit. So this is my IT problem. This is what it is. I want to go for cloud computing. Does it make sense or doesn't make sense? Then these guys will come up with some sort of report and see that, okay, their business problem fits into the cloud computing or not. So they play a very intermediary role, and we have to accept it. That's the way the world works. Because if I, as a technology company, go and talk to a customer, chances are they're saying that I'm like biased. I want to promote technology, or I'm putting technology on his plate because I'm a technology company. So this whole presentation is kind of thanks to KPMG and McKinsey for putting a lot of reports on the internet, all open, like open information, nothing confidential here. And I could read and skim and understand, okay, what actually customer talks of. At least from the India perspective, I may say so. This will also give you a presentation. This will also give you a perspective that if I am I'm not a Dell or HP or Cisco, I'm a SMB, where I'm going to invest my energy in cloud? Because cloud computing is growing. If you have seen Economic Times probably 2 days back, there were 8 VC fundings in 1 week for cloud. That's how hot is cloud. That's the way. I've known 2 of a very senior colleagues of mine in a different company who had quit their job and started a startup. And within 8 months, they got a $6 million funding on cloud. But what actually is getting funded? Is like infrastructure as a service getting funded, or a PaaS is getting funded, or a SaaS is getting funded, or a BPaaS is getting funded? Because these are the customer pain points. So this presentation will kind of touch among that. It's not high-end technology, so bear with me if you get bored with all the business talks. So this is kind of a little bit of evolution of, this has a laser? No? Okay. Kind of how everything grew from like mainframes to this virtual society of a Facebook or a LinkedIn, and the cloud computing when computing was supposed to become a utility. This kind of little bit of map there. It tells a lot of things that, okay, how the new business models came into picture, how we started talking of CapEx to OpEx versus computing, how we started talking of the elasticity of demand, like switching off the lights, how we started talking of activity-based costing, that if I am a business house, I run a textile business, I want to start a new business, how will I accommodate active cost of IT into my business? Earlier, IT was a small room, then the budget of IT became more than the business itself. And then they have to move to data center, and then they close down, and the outsourcing, and things like that. So this is kind of a graph for that how the things changed. Things changed because adaptability of IT, or we became more digital in our content. We started doing a lot of things digitally in terms of interaction, cell phones, social media, even professional contacts, recruitment. Most of the things started going to be offline. So this is kind of a map for that. Now if I looked into the definition of cloud computing and kind of skimmed out these 2 lines, which on the whole explains everything to everybody. Like internet-based data access and exchange, that's what we want to do in a plain and simple English. Internet-based access to the low-cost computing and application. The cost has to be low. And finally, there should be an application that is relevant to my business. I'm going to buy storage, but why I'm going to buy a storage? I'm not going to buy a 15-meter cloth. I want to buy a jeans to wear. So how does the business, so that's part of the application, that how does the business look into the investment in cloud computing? Now, characteristics, what we talk of is on-demand self-service, internet accessibility, pool resources, kind of, you can take a huge resource, position it to the different clients at the same time, so the cost of operation becomes low. If I have this room used by 500 people, suddenly the cost of this room becomes 1 by 500. If I have one guy sitting in this room, probably he bears the whole cost. That's the pool resourcing what we talk of. Usage-based billing, that's still coming up. I see a lot of interest around that. I heard a nice talk from PayPal and from Bharat, that how it's all bringing up from Ericsson. So it's good, but when we talk to the customer who are non-IT guys, we have PayPal is like tech-savvy company. Ericsson is a very tech-savvy company, HP one of the like pioneers, Dell and all. So we know what to do. However, when I talk to like big bazaars and future groups who are the real consumption, they have absolutely no clue today that what's going on. So when we go to position cloud in a non-technology company, if you come and talk to me, I'll say, hey, I can tell you 5 more things about what cloud does. When I go and talk to a non-IT company, these are the stakeholders which I see there. The CEO who has to do a business transformation because his bonus rests on that. He has to say that everybody talks cloud, I'm going to do the cloud too. Then there's a CFO and a CIO or a CTO who talks from the cost perspective, how will the whole infrastructure look into that. And there are IT managers and the teams and vendors and outsource partners who got to do the real work. So there has to have a visibility of cloud in terms of the top guy, the second guy, the second stage and the third stage. By the way, at the CEO level, chances are that he is not concerned with your implementing cloud at OpenStack or Amazon or a vCloud. His business is not, he doesn't even care about what sort of cloud you're implementing. So how will an OpenStack make a pitch there? Or is it feasible for OpenStack to go and pitch at that level? That's what we're trying to explain a little bit. Again, from this side of that, I told you that each one have a separate goal. So when we talk to them, like we have an opportunity to talk to all the three levels, we have a three different slide decks for them. One, we only talk about how is your business going to transform in terms of globalized business. When I come to CFO or CTO, the chances are I'll talk about how will I reduce your IT budget, CapEx to OpEx modeling. The third guy comes, I'll say, okay, I'll help you to scale out your, push out your patch to 20 different countries over time without breaking anything. So a different sort of conversation that you make in terms of the type of people you talk to. And then on the other side, we see, this is like kind of 1 year old, because I was a little lazy to do that and not well. I can do this, this is a whole of the maths I did. That how is Rackspace cloud business growing? So year on year growth, if you see, is kind of pretty high. So there was certainly consumption of cloud computing in the business wherever, everywhere in the world, but why not India? That's the question which puzzled me. If everybody in the world is consuming cloud from Rackspace, Amazon has an even better growth story. Why Indian businesses are not adapting to cloud? So then I look into that, okay, how does a cloud ecosystem looks? So we have like a supply side and a demand side. Supply side, most of the chances are, we sit on the supply side. We have a different role, somebody is a strategist, somebody is an architect, somebody is an implementer. I said